We are very excited today to welcome back Dr. Naima Charafi, who is an honorary member of Phi Beta Delta, which you'll hear a little bit more about later, our International Honor Society. And she's also, above all, a friend now of Phi Beta Delta, and she has been a wonderful friend. She spoke at our second induction ceremony, and she was so wonderful that she's been back. I think she spoke at a business school graduation, and she also set up the most wonderful visit to the United Nations for us, and she'll be doing that again. The only reason we didn't do it now is there was a student government visit set up, but nothing compared to the visit that she set up for us. So, I'm only going to give a very, very small introduction. Dr. Charafi has her PhD in social studies, as well as a dual master's degree in teaching in foreign language and adult education and leadership from La Sorbonne in Paris. She works at the United Nations, and her initiative is to protect people against violence based on gender. And she trains women to be peacekeepers for the United Nations, and has recently served in
Niger.
Rwanda, Benin, Burkina Faso, and Cameroon. And before that, she did work in Haiti. And you returned, where are we going next?
Actually, next week there is a mission in Togo, still in West Africa.
So she works with the French-speaking African nations and other French-speaking nations. And she's going to tell us about the work she does and maybe interest some of you in joining. And so I present you Dr. Naima Charafi.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
This is what you are used to do when you work in Africa, because we don't have the luxury of this kind of, you know, this kind of space. We don't have any mic, anything. We are used to speaking loud. So you can hear, if you can hear me, it's good. Can you hear me on the back?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So my name is Naima. Thank you so much for having me here. I'm a dear member of the faculty, of the administration, my friends. I don't consider myself more student, more faculty member, but just a friend. So thank you so much for having me. It's so nice to see new faces. My job here is mainly to just present a human face and a woman face in the world of the organization. As mentioned by Dr. Susan Sullivan, which I am very grateful for, her leadership, her continuous hospitality made this event happen. So I want to just briefly to present you the work of the organization in tackling the violence based on gender. When we talk about violence based on gender, what comes in your mind? Because those are keywords. What do you think about? Please? Rape? Yeah. But what do you know more? What do you know?
Female
sterilization. Yeah, female sterilization. You heard about something happening in ISIS. With the birth control, whoever, you heard about that? How they use birth control in order to freely rape the women. So we have also today, we have the special envoy to the UN, Ms. Jane Holmes. She is a general. She has been appointed by Ban Ki-moon to oversee abuse and sexual exploitation. So these keywords are reflecting threats and really, I would say, an act of war on women. And you know how, why? Women are the first target for any assailant, any terrorist. Do you have an idea why they target women first? Easy targets?
Women bring life.
Women bring life. Because we were talking with the UN police. They said, when you attack a woman, a mother, a woman is a sister. It's like you attack a state, isn't it? The state, the country, is like a house, a big house. And a small house is the family, the household. So when you attack a woman, when you rape a woman, when you discriminate in any fashion, it's like you are attacking the whole society. So now, I know that you are not specialist. My job here is just to show you what the United Nations is doing, its own mean, and how it is, I would say, realized in trainings. I am not a police officer. I am not a member of authority or government and all this. I'm just a simple trainer. I'm like my colleagues here, member of faculty. I, as mentioned by Dr. Sullivan, I specialize in social studies. So you ask me why social studies, what makes you become big part of the training on peacekeeping? Just the curiosity. We were talking with my colleague, Valeria Belmonte, the curiosity, being aware of what's going on in the world, and knowing that you can make a difference. So I, my little self, did a little bit of a difference in being curious. Ça va? Looking at me. Okay, so, I'm just, and especially why this month is very, it's not a mistake, it's purposely chosen, because this month is the month of the celebration of the right of women, raising awareness on the right of women, promoting gender in inclusion of women as a full actors in this process. So this month of March, this event today has a whole resonance. And I would like to show first the UN and its actions, and maybe some pictures and videos of my previous missions in Rwanda, Benin, etc. Are we all okay with this program?
Yeah.
And we will find like 5 to 10 minutes for your questions, and please don't be shy. So, first I'd like to show you, just to build a global perspective, a map, where the UN missions are deployed. When I talked about missions is like peacekeeping, peace solving, peace maintaining mission in the world. So according to you, in what continent we have the most missions? In Africa. And in Africa, we have different territories. It's more like Francophone, French-speaking Africa, or more English-speaking Africa. According to you, you're not a specialist, but we can work around this. French-speaking. When you have French-speaking, what do you hear about? You hear, we heard about something going on the violence in Mali. Do you have any other countries? Congo, Côte d'Ivoire, did you hear about what happened yesterday in Côte d'Ivoire? What happened? A bomb, terrorist attack. So, and here, we have, you have also the Republic of Central Africa, you have Somalia. So here is the peacekeeping missions that are deployed. And in there you have civilians, they could be engineers, business project managers, they could be electoral assistance specialists, but you have also the security contingent. When I talk about security contingents, you have the police and the military. So according to you, police and military, who is closest to the population in need? The police. So the police engage with the population. And here, in the initiative of fighting gender-based violence and other issues, the police is the main body to tackle those problems. So I'm going to talk specifically on the role that women are playing in keeping the peace in a conflict zone, and how hiring women is more and more a concern and an issue for all the world, all the member states of the UN. So this is a growing aspect that I'm really happy to share with you. I'll also show you, because videos play more than many words, a day in the life of a woman peacekeeper. It's only 2 3-minute videos, and after my experience and stories.
Let's see if it works.
recruit police female officers because they act in various capacities. They could protect the civilian, they could also bring a kind of a training to the local police. They also they sound more approachable for any person victim of rape or any kind of discrimination or any kind of crime. You see that? You see the figures. Did you have a look on the figures? The percentage we started with how many percent of women? One. So for the member states, maybe even like the national police, it was not important to have women. And did you keep in mind what was the percentage in 2014? 29. At the time I'm talking, now we have almost 35% of women. So all this is not only like figures and all this. In order to recruit those women, how can we change a woman who is police officer in Bangladesh, in Senegal, how can we make that this person be recruitable by the UN? You think it's the same work? I am a NYPD, LAPD female officer. Can I just come and say, okay, I'm interested, I can join you guys in Liberia and Congo? So how does it work, according to you? What is needed?
Training.
Training in what? Yeah, training interest, training on the issues. So it's not easy for women to join the UN. And according to you, they are recruited to be deployed. Police woman is essentially a woman. A woman can just leave her household, her family, and go for two years mission in Haiti? This is a rhetorical question. No, they have babies, they have family, and they need also sometimes the support of their husband, etc. So even though they are professional and totally recruitable, we face actually problems in having them released and training them. So once the member said, because this is also an initiative that is forcing in a way member states, it could be US, it could be Canada, it could be India, it could be China, forcing countries to train, to recruit and train their national female police officers in order after to be deployed in the UN mission. Do you understand me? So it's not only about the UN, it's how we can promote and in a way force the member states to train and recruit more women. Here, I would like to show you a short video of one day in the life of a police woman in the film. This woman actually comes from Ghana. So she was a police officer in Ghana, and she was released by her country to join a mission in Liberia. Are you familiar with the situation in Liberia? No, big bloodbath, crime field, mass executions. You know, all those countries experience war and conflict. Is it based on only political issues? Congo and Liberia and now Republic of Central. What? My question is, what is driving the violence? What?
Diamonds.
We have diamonds. In Congo, we have the mineral, zinc, thing, exactly. But whatever you need to get that, I don't know, iPhone and all this, is resources, diamond and all this. This is what triggered the violence and the war. So here, you will see the story, actually, a story of a woman who decided, with her own inspiration and dedication, to join the UN and to leave her family behind.
Peacekeeping troops stationed in Liberia, 250 are female,
Military officials say the women soldiers are helping to change the nature of the job, and women become vital to that mission's success. A day in the life of Ghanaian Sergeant Dora Godoy sheds light on why women are changing the character of the PCA. It's 5 a.m. and Sergeant Dora Godoy is beginning her day with a prayer. This soldier and mother of one says her Muslim faith gives her the strength to survive the challenges of being a peacekeeper in a troubled land. The brief moment of spiritual peace is abruptly followed by a grueling 2.5-hour physical fitness training session. Sergeant Dodoy's son will soon turn 5. She clearly misses him a lot, but says the sacrifice is worth it.
It's quite convenient because I'm trained to be a professional soldier, to be called upon to carry any assignment at any time.
The Ghanaian peacekeepers are known as Gambat 10. There are 700 of them stationed in Liberia's economically depressed second city of Buchanan. Sergeant Godoy is one of only 41 women among the contingent.
Ladies and gentlemen, this patrol is very dear to your command. And I entreat all of you to be extra vigilant and careful. Because you've been waiting for a long time, and all of a sudden they are leaving you off. It's not going to be easy, but how are they going to feed their family?
Daily, Sergeant Dodoy leads a team of 9 soldiers in a patrol around Buchanan. They talk to people, instill confidence in their military presence, and look for signs of potential unrest. Buchanan is an important economic center for this region of Liberia, but recent layoffs in the mining sector have worsened already high rates of unemployment, especially among the youths, raising the potential for social unrest and crime. Sergeant Dodoy believes the children of Buchanan are suffering the most from the town's economic plight.
Most of the children are on the streets pushing trucks. Some are walking around. They ask me, interact with them, why? They say they have to watch, do something to support themselves, to be able to enable them to go to school.
It's well established that women and children are often the main victims of war and its aftermath. Experts say their well-being is of primary importance in peacekeeping operations. Along with that view is the belief that women peacekeepers engage and reassure the communities they serve, and therefore play a vital role in UN peacekeeping missions.
Women in peacekeeping in general, the role cannot be overemphasized. They are the pillars upon which security can be developed. They are the people who are suffering the brunt of conflict most. And to address these issues, women will have to be brought on board as peacekeepers to understand them and to be able to address their issues. Once the issues of women and children are effectively addressed, the effect of conflict on the society can very much be reduced. And the role of women in Gambia cannot be overemphasized because they are doing exactly what I'm talking about, bringing on board the views of women into our planning processes for effective conduct of our operations.
When the patrol is done, a debriefing session evaluates the day's findings. This allows the battalion to assess the security situation. After the debriefing, the women soldiers return to their compound. Now it's time for them to catch up with each other. That means doing their chores and relaxing.
And also dancing.
Shoot.
well, you know, after a drink maybe. I cannot help them to see how to drive. I don't even have my driving license. I'm a failure. So I'm teaching them how to write reports, how to develop their analytical skills. Because for a police person, for any people, you also, you have an information, an incident, you have to be able to report it. Who, when, help me to finish?
Where?
How, what happened? They have this information and how to write security reports. So this is why I was sent. I was actually training the Canadian police, the US police, and the Canadian US police, the UN people already deployed in the missions, and all the other ladies, because it was what we call all female training for free deployment. So this is the specificity of this training is only female candidate. So the first one was in August 2014. It was Mwanda. We had 280 female candidates to take the test. Remember, the test was driving. It's a 4x4. It's a UN vehicle. And after the second test, shooting on the standards of the UN. Okay, with the security and all that. And the third one. Well, a security report, exactly. So we had 80% success on this training for the pre-deployments. And immediately after passing the test, the women were deployed in the Republic of Central Africa to protect the president and also to protect the elections. So we saw them. We saw them going with like the big vehicles, all this, the convoys and all this. After we worked with Benin. Benin actually, we had the country gave us only it's relatively 80 participants, but only 25% of those 80 succeeded. You know why? How come in Rwanda 80% succeeded and in Benin 20 to 24? Police officers that stopped actually their studies, the school, maybe at the age of 12 or 13. And we had this, not knowing how to write, but they didn't have the chance to hold a gun because the gun were for men. So they have, in the same Benin police, the men police officers were the one to hold the gun, but not for the women. The women were sent in just to regulate the traffic, you know? Traffic lights and all this, etc. And also, they are not allowed to convert vehicles. So you can see the challenge for us in 2 weeks, teaching them how to write while they left school at 12 years old, you know? Second, teaching them how to shoot and also drive vehicles. So of course, this kind of training, even though they don't succeed in passing the test, there is a positive impact because we help those women to see the gap that they need to fill, and we provide them, the UN expert provide them with more knowledge, more experience, more competencies. So even though they don't succeed pass the test, they can take it the very next year and all this, and they feel more confident. So when I was talking about those tests, it's not the only training that we do. Because what we face, especially in Niger, this was my experience in December, is women being put aside in their own country, even though they are police officers, they were lacking of confidence. They were actually, I would say, not believing really in themselves. So my colleagues, the Canadians, the Americans, and the UN did a lot of mentoring. A mentor, yes, you can do it. Yes, we trust you. Yes, the UN needs you. Yes, you can make a difference. And what kind of pride, if you take the exam and when you are deployed, what kind of pride you are for your family and for your country? And of course, if the country can show the good percentage of success, it's also the pride of the country, the face of the country to the United Nations. So we had to do a lot of capacity building, confidence building. So it was very touching and galvanizing. At the end, I would like to show you some pictures. So this is me, Rwanda.